Disgraced former crypto mogul Sam Bankman-Fried has been convicted of defrauding FTX customers. This is one of the biggest financial frauds on record. A 12-member jury in a Manhattan federal court convicted the FTX founder of all 7 counts of fraud and money laundering after a month-long trial. Prosecutors had accused Bankman-Fried of lying to investors and lenders and stealing billions of dollars from his cryptocurrency exchange firm, helping to precipitate its collapse. The 31-year-old could face decades in prison when his sentence is determined at a later date. Manhattan's top federal prosecutor welcomes the conviction. Bankman-Fried's lawyers, meanwhile, vow to appeal the verdict.
Sam Bankman-Fried perpetrated one of the biggest financial frauds in American history, a multi-billion dollar scheme designed to make him the king of crypto. But here's the thing. The cryptocurrency industry might be new. The players like Sam Bankman-Fried might be new. But this kind of fraud, this kind of corruption is as old as time, and we have no patience for it.
U.S. Treasury Secretary Janet Yellen reassures Asian countries they don't need to take sides between the U.S. and China. Speaking ahead of the Asia-Pacific Economic Cooperation Summit in San Francisco later this month, Yellen said a U.S. approach to China would not lead to a disastrous division of the global economy. Yellen added a full decoupling of the U.S. and Chinese economies is not practical given the complexity of Asian supply chains and the region's deep economic ties to Beijing.
We know the U.S.-China relationships is among the most consequential in the world, and we need to get it right for Americans and for people around the world, including across the Indo-Pacific. That begins with a serious, clear-eyed economic approach. As I've said, the United States does not seek to decouple from China. A full separation of our economies or an approach in which countries, including those in the Indo-Pacific, are forced to take sides would have significant negative global repercussions. We have no interest in such a divided world and its disastrous effects.
Japanese Prime Minister Fumio Kishida now in Manila for a two-day visit. The plane carrying the Japanese leader landed just moments ago in Manila. Joining him there is his wife, Mrs. Yuko Kishida. Now, Tokyo's Prime Minister will meet with President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. today for a series of talks in Malacañang. He's also set to address a special joint session of Congress on Saturday. We'll bring you more updates on his visit later in the program and in our succeeding newscasts.
Finally, an agriculture chief for the Philippines. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. hands over the agriculture portfolio to fishing tycoon Francisco Chu Laurel Jr. Laurel arrives at the agency at a time of higher commodity prices and stubborn inflation. Pia Gutierrez reports.
Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. is finally stepping down as the country's agricultural chief over a year into his term. This after naming billionaire fishing tycoon Francisco Chu Laurel Jr. as a full-time secretary of the Department of Agriculture. Marcos Jr. made the announcement in a hastily called briefing Friday morning, shortly after he administered the oath of office to Laurel in Malacañang. The president expressed confidence that the new agriculture chief will be able to address the many issues facing the country's agriculture sector, given his vast experience in the area. Laurel is president of the Frabel Fishing Corporation, one of the largest tuna fishing companies, and he is also the chairman of the World Tuna Purse Seine Organization, an organization comprised of the world's biggest tuna fishing fleets. He's also the chairman and president of the Agusan Power Corporation and have held positions in various companies, including president of the Frabel Shipyard Corporation, chairman of the Westpac Meat Processing Corporation, director of Frabel Properties Corporation, and president of the Markham Resources Corporation. He's also honorary consul of the Consulate of the Federated States of Micronesia in the Philippines.
We have found somebody who understands very well the problems that agriculture is facing. The reason for the timing is that now we are confident, Secretary Kiko and I are confident, that we have a fair understanding, a good understanding of what it is that needs to be done. And the reason that I held on to the position of Secretary of Agriculture was that I truly believed, and I think I was proven right, that there are many things that only a president could do.
Sadly, among the president's marching orders to the new DA secretary is to try to gain control of the prices of all agricultural commodities that are going up amid the effects of climate change and the avian and swine flu. He also directed Laurel to increase agricultural production, bring down the cost of production through efforts such as mechanization. And in his speech, Laurel Jr. vowed to implement to the letter President Marcos Jr.'s programs and policies on agriculture.
Buong puso ko pong tinatanggap ang hamon ng ating mahal na Pangulo na maglingkod bilang kalihim ng kagawaran ng agrikultura. Una sa lahat, nagpapasalamat ako kay Pangulong Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr. sa kanyang tiwala at sa pagkakataong binigay sa akin na makapagsilbi sa sektor ng agrikultura. Pangunahing adhikain ko ang pagtiyak na sagana ang ating ani at siguraduhin ito ay nakakarating sa hapag ng bawat Pilipino. Layunin ko na tiyakin na may sapat at masustansyang pagkain na mabibili ang ating mga kababayan sa tamang halaga. Susi dito ang modernisasyon ng sektor ng agrikultura kasabay ng pagpabubuti sa kapakanan ng mga kapatid nating magsasaka at mangingisda.
Laurel also vowed to open his office for farmers and fishermen whom he says are close to his heart. Laurel says he will be going to the Department of Agriculture later today to meet the agency's employees.